Hey guys! So today I'm going to show you how I do a detailed chibi commission, and I'm working with a commission that I got at Comic-Con 2016. And it is for a 9x12 detailed chibi, and I have a reference photo to work from. Since these are real people with real lives, I'm not going to show their likeness on camera as much as possible, except for the drawing itself. So when I draw figures, and I think I did a figure rendering tutorial for you guys, when I draw figures, I, especially commissions where people are posing, or if I need to come up with specific poses, I will go ahead and block in the torsos first, because those are the center of the body in most poses, and they're going to take up the most space. Now, with the detailed chibi commissions, one of the elements of the style are these large chibi kind of bulbous heads. Like, that's just the style. So I do have to often make accommodations for head size. And many of the principles that I use for regular figure drawing hold true for the chibi style. The difference is that it's more stylized, so certain elements are going to be very exaggerated. And that's why, if you are interested in becoming an artist, regardless of style, I really highly recommend you take the time to understand human anatomy as it really is. And there's some fantastic resources to help you with that if you're not in classes, or even if you're in classes and maybe your professor's method of teaching anatomy doesn't help. For me, the Glenn Vilppu manual was Glenn Vilppu drawing manual, which is available on Amazon. Through his company. It was a fantastic resource. It really showed me how to break down human anatomy in a way that was applicable for comics. There wasn't an overemphasis on physical landmarks, because in comics, especially if you have a cartoony style or in animation, those landmarks aren't necessarily even going to hold true. So if you are trying to learn anatomy and you have a cartoony style, or you'd like to have a cartoony style, I really recommend you check that book out, and I'll have it linked below in my description. So I try to rough almost everything out before I move on to doing any details. So right now we have two heads, which are just like a ball with a spade attached. And she's got sticks for arms and legs, and he's about to have sticks for arms and legs. And that way, if I need to erase or reposition anything, I haven't lost too much effort. One of the things that beginner artists, they tend to fall prey to, is they start drawing the details too early in, and they either run out of space on the page, or one part of the character looks great and the rest looks awful. If you work everything out at sort of the same pace, you're going to eliminate a lot of those problems. Now, with my detailed chibi style, we already have noticed that we have the large heads. Another element that goes into my detailed chibi style are the sort of enlarged feet and ankles. It sort of balances out. Enlarged lower arms and hands. I find that kind of balances out how big the head is. It gives it a sense of proportion, even though it is exaggerated proportion. So this is pretty much the basic template for how my detailed chibis are drawn. I don't always draw this pose. I'm working from a photo reference. They pose for me, but I can draw any pose I'm given or asked to draw by breaking anatomy down in this easy to understand, easy to replicate way. And I am thoroughly convinced that I can teach this method to almost anybody, and they're going to see improvement in their art. I've done several panels where I teach this method, and I've also volunteered at several schools. I helped one girl. She was really struggling with anatomy, and she was testing to get into a fine arts high school. And by teaching her my normal figure way of breaking down anatomy, she was able to get in because it finally started to click for her. And she definitely was going to become a mangaka and move to Japan. So we butted heads for a while at first. Because I was just like, oh no, you have to learn anatomy. And I think the problem was she couldn't see how it could be applied to the style she wanted to have. Finally I showed her how I draw, which is fairly manga influenced because that's what made me fall in love with comics was manga. I wouldn't be reading comics at all if it hadn't been for like Inuyasha 17 years ago at a Suncoast. Like, that style spoke to me. So I understand the frustration when people say to you, the fact that you were inspired by manga, that's not legitimate enough. You're not a good enough artist. You're just a weeaboo. Why don't you become a real artist? And even though I've studied fine art at one school and studied comics at another, I keep returning to the thing that made me fall in love with comics in the first place. So to me, that's as legitimate an influence as anything else. And anybody who gives you shade for it is either not an artist, or they have a bias that you're not going to be able to correct, or they are unfamiliar with the long history of exchange between the West and the East in terms of culture and products and even art styles. Once she realized that I had a similar influence as her, she started taking me seriously because she knew I wasn't just trying to get her to stop drawing something because I had a personal bias against it. I was legitimately trying to help her become a stronger artist. And even if you don't have a manga style, Glenn Vilppu worked for Disney, so, I mean, if you, he just does beautiful work, you know? So I think it would be hard to find fault with somebody learning their anatomy through him. I also took a constructive human anatomy class with Paul Hudson while I was at SCAD. And that helped a lot, too. But I really think if I didn't know the basics from Glenn Vilppu, I wouldn't have the things I learned in Hudson's class just would not have had anything to stick to in my brain. So I really think the Glenn Vilppu drawing manual is one of the better anatomy resources out there, especially if you want to draw comics, you want to do animation. Now I'm starting that. Flesh in some of the details. So, all right. So here's a confession. I enjoyed Star Wars 4, 5, and 6 when I was a girl, and I even read the novels, but I just haven't stayed with the franchise. So he's dressed as like, it's not a stormtrooper. It looks like a variation on a Boba Fett costume. And it looks great. Like his costume is amazing, but I don't know who he's dressed as. So I can't tell you guys, but I just finished drawing in his helmet, and it looks like there's a split cape in the back. So I'm going to draw that in, and she's wearing a dress. So even the facial features start out generic and progress towards specific. And even though it is a stylized style, I do want to capture specific elements of their faces that make these people look like who they are. It's not just some generic thing and everybody always looks the same and I don't care. Part of why I am very popular with people as a portrait artist for this sort of thing is because I do try to put that extra effort in to make it look like them, but them in this style. And I think if you want to be a convention commission artist, you need to like people, first of all. You need to be interested in people, and you need to be interested in what makes them unique and special, because it's capturing those likenesses. It's capturing that attention to detail that makes your customers like your work. It makes them resonate with the stuff you produce and makes them happy when they see it. You're trying to capture all of their best features and downplay things they might not like so much without getting rid of it either. Because then it wouldn't be them. I mean, the things that we don't like about ourselves can often become the thing we like the most because it's our defining feature. When I was a girl, I read Anne of Green Gables, and Anne spent an inordinate amount of time trying to get rid of her freckles. And, you know, as a girl, I really wasn't into my freckles. I kind of saw them as like a defect. I don't know why. I read all this garbage stuff written from like the 19th and early 20th century where women had only the milkiest of pale skin. And I don't know, I was stupid and my head was filled with that garbage, right? So I tried to get rid of my freckles, and now I'm an adult and I like my freckles. They're cute. I think freckles are cute. And I wish I hadn't read those books, because those books made me sad about who I was as a person. And they might be considered, you know, classics, but some of the ideas they've got going in them maybe need to not, I'm not saying censor it, but, you know, take it with a grain of salt. So, the basic sketch is almost done, at least for her. For him, I still have some details to do. Wow. And in case you guys are wondering, I'm using Color Eno Blue Lead in Soft Blue 0.7, and there will be a link to that in the description. I get mine off of Amazon because I like that two-day shipping. And it's a product that I really don't see in stores. So you, dang it. All right, need to refill. You really won't, you really won't find it in person unless you're fortunate. Maybe if you live like near a Kinokuniya or like a Japanese stationery store, you would be able to find it. If you live in Japan, you'll be able to find it. But it's still kind of hard to find. You can use Colorase pencils. And especially for this sort of thing where I'm going to be doing a transfer anyway, so no one is going to see this except for you guys, of course. No one's going to see this rendition. You could really use any sort of color lead you like. And on commissions where the purchaser would actually be seeing the blue lines, I would never be this loose. But since they're not going to see this portion of it, they're going to receive the watercolor. And this is going to go, this portion of it is going to end up getting thrown away anyway, because it's going to have graphite on the back. It's going to be messy. I don't really worry about being too neat on this part. Ugh. Anyway, that is the basic sketch for my detailed chibi commissions. I hope you guys found this useful. I hope you found it helpful. I hope you will think about what I said regarding the Glenn Vilppu drawing manual and learning anatomy in order to have a well-rounded, well-grounded original art style, because the basics can be bent and twisted and turned in all sorts of ways to make your art look original and different, but it will still feel solid and also make you more flexible as an artist, because if somebody wants you to do a different style, you already understand the basic frameworks. You're not reliant on what you can do in your style. You can adapt. I'm Becky Hilburn. I hope you guys have a great day. I'll see you in a bit when I am working on the watercolor for this. Bye. Okay, so as in my other commission videos, for this technique, I covered the back with graphite, because we're going to do a graphite transfer. And as in those videos as well, what we're going to do is we're going to place... Oh, that's going to look nice. That's a nice big commission. We're going to place the image down and then tape it with a low-tack tape. Now, you can use washi tape, you can use masking tape, you can use scotch tape if you're careful. Really, we don't need this to stay here forever. We just need to stay here long enough for us to go over the image with a harder pencil and transfer that graphite onto that watercolor paper. So I'm going to go ahead and do that, and I'll get back with you guys. All right, so my image has been entirely penciled over. I try to use a fair amount of pressure when I'm doing these graphite transfers, because I want as clear a transfer as possible. So I'm just removing some of the tape to make sure this transfer was a good one. You don't want to remove all the tape in case you do have to replace it, and it looks pretty dang solid. Awesome. Sorry, getting a little dry here. There is one area I'm going to go over, and that's this side of his neck plate. But other than that, I am pretty excited. So with these, oh gee, they are going to be so cute. with these take-home commissions, I've been using them as an excuse to break out my Brusho. This is a Garris that I did as a Comic-Con commission as well. Doesn't he look great? So I think I might do a turquoise Brusho on the background. Or maybe their sea green color, because that's also a very nice color. And his uniform is white, black, red, and like kind of a distress color, so I think the turquoise will be like a nice visual pop. And her dress, let me double check, her shoes are brown for sure, and she has kind of reddish brown hair. Her dress is also a red and a purple, so I think the turquoise is going to be a solid choice. So for this sort of thing, there's a couple of ways you can handle your Brusho. You can sprinkle it on first, and I have mine in these cute little salt and pepper shakers. Or you can wet your paper down and then sprinkle your Brusho. Now, if you do the sprinkle Brusho first, spray water second, it may become difficult for you to control where the color is going. And in colors like green, you kind of want to avoid those on skin tones, because you can't rescue that. I think I am going to spray first, sprinkle, and then maybe spray again. And this is just plain water that I'm sort of spraying around the figures. And you see, I already got some Brusho very faintly on there. Now for sprinkles. And I like doing it this way because you can get some really nice color effects with very little effort. And with these sort of affordable commissions, I am all about finding ways to give my customers a really good effect without sort of overworking myself. Okay, so we can spray it again and see how the color really starts to bloom. And I've got a paper towel handy because if it starts getting too much on the skin, I'm going to need to do a salvage mission. Some of my color around, so I need to go get some water. There's a cup of clean water, and I'm just trying to move some of the color around. Sort of break up some of the areas where it's just like a bunch of crystals sitting there. But I don't want to work it too much, because if I work it too much, I'm going to lose some of the swirling effect that looks so nice. I am going to go in here though and fill that in a bit, as well as this area here. Oh, you want to be careful to keep your hands from getting into it. If you have a mall stick, this is a great time to pull it out. Some of that off of his face. And once this is fully dry, I'm going to wipe the whole thing down to get, because there is some Brusho on their skin, and I don't want to activate that because I don't want a bunch of green and blue on their skin. Now, there are ways you can sort of mask this off. I could have used Frisket, or, well, no, I really shouldn't have used Frisket, but I have some graphics mask paper. Maybe that is Frisket. Actually, I think that is Frisket. I was thinking of Miskit, which is the latex-based stuff. I didn't want to pull that out because it's such a large area to cover. You're going to end up with significant paper damage. But that looks pretty cool. So this is going to take pretty much forever to dry. You can start soaking up some of the excess water if you want, trying to be careful not to disturb your paints too much. I'm going to try and pick this area up so it's not on her skin, if I can help it. On him, that doesn't matter quite as much because it's not going to be a skin tone, and I can rescue some of it. Just activating some of the Brusho that's in some of those areas that are between the characters. Don't want it to go in her skin, or his skin, really. All right, now to let this fully dry before I can brush away the excess Brusho. Now, if I'd done it the other way, where I wet the entire surface of the paper, or rather wet the areas I wanted the Brusho to activate on, and then sprinkled the Brusho in, the effect would be different, and I might not be doing this right now. Problem is, paper absorbs the water, and so it can kind of feather out, and you can end up with color in areas you don't want it to be in anyway. So I figured I would just go ahead and deal with it. And I think I've mentioned in other videos that I really like sort of going to the brink of ruin and then rescuing whatever I've done from that. Okay, so the brush has been pretty much set. I am going to, pointing away from the characters, activate some areas that hadn't been fully activated. Try to get them moving so it's not just like pockets of dye sitting. All right, so this piece has had a few hours to dry, and now I can finally start making some progress on it. I'm going to go ahead and mix up a skin tone and activate my colors by putting a drop of water on each of the pans. Give that a moment to catch up. Okay, so my paint has had a minute to absorb the water, and I can now start mixing my first set of skin tones. And I'm still using that Sakura Koi 12 color set that I used in the detailed Chibi video. Now, the nice thing about the yellow ochre in this set is that it's a little bit transparent, so that's going to help hide some of the turquoise blue that unintentionally ended up on the skin. And the pink, it's a little redder than I normally would mix, will also help tone that down. For those of you who wear makeup, it's sort of like how if you have like acne and you want to cover that up, you use a green tinted concealer. Well, it's like the reverse. If you want to make the skin look like skin and not like a zombie, and you have green tint underneath, then you need to make the skin a little bit pinker than you normally would. And as always, it will dry a little bit lighter than it's applied. So you may need to mix subsequent layers darker, or you may just want to build up your skin tone with lots of layers. Either are fine options. Now, theoretically, because the brusho takes such a long time to dry when you're applying it, if you wanted to, you could do several batches at one time, give them time to dry, and come back to them throughout the week. So basically prepare backgrounds ahead of time. I'm sort of taking it on a case-by-case basis. So I haven't allowed myself that luxury. Plus, I don't have the room over here to work on that. All right, so I'm going to let this dry before I move on to my next layer. All right, since that first layer has dried, I can go in and knock out another layer. And this more red skin tone does a really good job of standing out against the green, sort of knocking it back some. Hopefully, by the time this whole thing is finished, the characters themselves will really stand out nicely against the backdrop. Right now, I know the backdrop looks sort of overwhelming, but we've already done two commissions with this sort of heavily rendered background. So I'm confident that I'll be able to handle it. And I'm doing the second layer on the skin. So this is when I can start putting in shadows and darkening some layers up so that they recede into the background. Especially down here on the legs, which took the most green. I had the most trouble fighting with the brusho down here, so I'm definitely going to do another layer. Okay. And while I'm waiting on that to dry, I'll go ahead and start mixing up the color for her hair. Now in the photo, I said she had red brown hair, but it's actually more like strawberry blonde. So I'm going to start with a base of like a very bright yellow and work my way slightly darker. That way it gives me somewhere, that it gives me room to move. And I'll go ahead and start mixing up the color for her blush. And his uniform has a lot of smaller shapes going on. So I need to sort of approach it as strategically as possible. Usually, if I am painting something black, I will either paint it gray first or I'll paint it indigo first. That way it's not just like a flat black that's kind of boring to look at. I'm going to do the same here. I'm going to start with some indigo and then I'm going to add a little bit of black. This way we have room to do reflections and to build up shadow because it reads more realistically and it's also more visually interesting on this style of commission if I don't just automatically go for the darkest shade possible. Unfortunately for me, the weather isn't as damp as it was yesterday, so I think we are going to move a little bit quicker than I was able to in previous days. And the black definitely seems a little bit anemic right now, but by the time I'm finished with this painting, it's going to stand out a lot more. Now, if you're a commission artist and you're just getting started, it might be tempting to knock as many of the details back as possible to make this as simplified as possible. But what I've found is you really needs a good balance. It needs to look reminiscent of what it's supposed to be. Like, people should be able to tell what it is, but it shouldn't become so cluttered with details that it's no longer cute. If the sort of commissions you specialize in, like myself, are cute commissions, then you need to find a way to make what you're rendering recognizable, but also appealing and adorable, I guess, for lack of a better word. But this also goes back to what I was saying earlier about how when you're doing commissions, it's important to try to capture a likeness as much as you can while it's still fitting into that style. Okay, so that black definitely be mixed a little bit darker. And her hair is dry. Her skin is not, I mean, the hair that would be touching her face is dry. So I can do the first layer of that. Yeah, it's a dry night tonight, so this should be a lot quicker. And if you are going to take commissions, you also need to think about why you're taking commissions. For me, they are an important source of income. I do make a fair bit of money doing this, but I also do a lot of commissions at cons. It is not an easy way to make money. If you're looking for an easy way to make money and you don't like drawing on the spot, you don't like drawing for people, you're uncomfortable with people watching you draw, you should consider some other way of monetizing your art, like through prints or through comics, something that you can prepare ahead of time and you don't have to be on the spot. Now, often when people watch me draw, their reactions and their expressions, it's like I'm doing magic for them. So I find that really gratifying. So I enjoy, even though sometimes I'm exhausted and I've done so many commissions and I'm just ready to go home, but I still enjoy doing magic for people. And I don't mean magic like a magic trick. I mean, like, it's like alchemy. You're taking raw materials and you're creating something that makes someone happy. And I guess in that light, magic tricks are also actual magic, because they can win people over and make people happy and make people believe in magic for just a minute. And that's a gift to be able to give people that. He has very dark brown hair, so I am mixing that up and checking to see if his hair is touching hers, because if it is, I have to wait until her hair has fully dried before I can start rendering his hair. But while I do that, I can go ahead and do the shadows on their eyes. And that's with just a little bit of indigo. And putting that shadow on the eye really helps the eye pop and sort of sparkle. So I recommend you do it. And I have found that I like doing the sort of half eye shadows, if that makes sense. So half the eye is covered. And then I dab up some of the wet paint to sort of make it more of a gradient. Then I can go back in and blend a little bit using water. So I'll be back. I need to let this dry. Actually, wait, I can do the cheeks really quick. Something else that I like about commissions is sometimes I can help people see themselves the way they really are. So sometimes when people trust me with commissioning their likeness, you can tell that they don't necessarily have high self-esteem. They're kind of antsy about asking. They're really afraid that I'm going to make them look terrible. And I love it when they trust me, because I know I can get them to see what I see. So I'll always put a lot of effort into making sure the commission turns out good and it's a good likeness, but it's also, you know, the best traits are the most prominent. So that's also a really rewarding experience for me. So if you enjoy that sort of people work, then commissions might be something that you consider taking at conventions. If you don't enjoy that, or if you have trouble seeing that side of people, though, I would really recommend you stay away from commissions, because you can do a lot of damage. And a lot of these people are a bit fragile. You know, they're really trusting you. So to take advantage of that trust, it's not something you should do. And if you're not sure where you fall, then maybe practice with some of your friends and see how you feel as you complete different portraits. And if you aren't a people person, but you like animals, then pet commissions might be a really good way to sort of bridge that gap, because you still have the chance to make people happy, but you're making people happy by drawing an animal that they love. And I think any pet owner knows how much you can love a pet, but how short their time with you can be. So I think pet portraits are a really nice way to sort of keep this beloved animal with you forever. In fact, I need to commission a bunch of people to draw. I have a few pictures of Bowie that I've commissioned, but I could definitely do with more. As well as my mom's cat, Remy. She used to be mine, but my mom kind of kept her when I went to grad school instead of letting me take her with her. So she's definitely my mom's cat now. And I should probably either do some portraits of Remy for my mom, or commission a friend to paint her. And I like keeping my reference on my phone, because it's just really handy for me. I use my phone for almost everything. And it means I can get started on these if I'm in the car or if I'm going somewhere. As long as I have my sketchbook, I can get a start. It also, the small size also kind of helps me distill the most important features of someone, which definitely helps with this sort of form of caricature. So my smartphone is definitely a tool that I can't, absolutely can't live without. And you also don't need the latest and greatest. I have a 4S and I've had it for several years and it works just well. Doesn't I can't say it works just fine, but it works fine for what I'm doing right here. Works great for what I'm doing. It takes photos and it's got room to store them. That's really all I need. It would be great if I had room for some of the newer apps, would make life a little bit easier, but you really don't need too much fancy stuff. Just a smartphone that can access internet will really go a long way. Okay, so he's kind of blocked in. So now I can start painting her. And her dress is red and purple. And I'm going to start, I might regret this, but we'll see. I'm going to start by just doing like a base coat with this sort of warm, translucent red. It's like a blue red. And that way, I can just go ahead and put like either a layer of a purple that I've mixed or a blue, a very thin layer of like indigo, and that should make the purple for me. And I really don't mind that the red on her dress is bleeding into the red on his uniform. They're slightly different reds, but I'm going to be building up the red on his uniform bit by bit. So it's not really a problem. But so far, this commission is a lot of fun, and I think it's turning out really cute. And I'm really happy they asked me to draw them. I like drawing couples. I like drawing kids. I like drawing people who are friends. Like I like drawing people who are happy to be with each other. Like I like being part of that happy memory or being able to help them commemorate those things. I mean, that's a form of immortality. Even something as sort of flip as an anime convention commission, like I'm not kidding myself, but it's a way to help people create a tangible memory of themselves doing something that they enjoyed. And even if they only keep that picture around for a year, or heck, I mean maybe even 10 years, that's still important. Like you left an impact on someone else's life. And I know I get kind of lectury on here, but I think of myself for some of you guys, I think of myself as like your comics big sister. And there's a lot of great things about what I do, even if the money is not great at all. And for some of you, I'm your peer, so I want to encourage you and cheer for you in the background. So I think I'd like to go a lot darker with his hair, but this is a good start because it gives me somewhere to build up from. That's another thing about watercolor is you don't have to hit it on the first swing, you know? As long as you're doing lighter layers, you can kind of approach it and build up to it. Which honestly, in my opinion, I mean, if I like gouache, I don't like painting with gouache. I hate painting with gouache, but I like when other people use gouache. I like how that looks. But for me and what I love to do, which is watercolor and marker, I really like that translucency and like that light play that happens from like different layers and the light bouncing off of those different layers. Like that's what I like to see. So that's what I try to bring to my work. So that's why it's okay to start kind of light and build your way up. I mean, these watercolors have a, my only real complaint is, as you can see, like this is like really opaque compared to how translucent I was getting. I just didn't mix in enough water. Some of the colors will go down opaque even if you do mix in water, which not only makes them inconsistent, it makes what if you try to do more elaborate pieces than this with these colors, it's going to get muddy. So that's one of the reasons why I can't necessarily recommend these. I use them a lot and I like them, but I am aware of their shortcomings. And when I recommend something, it's because I think overall it performs really well and it can handle a lot of the things I throw at it, or it's very inexpensive and it's very accessible, so there's no reason not to give it a shot. Like, I try to be stingy in my wholehearted recommendations because I want that to have meaning for you guys. When I tell you, like, I genuinely love this product, it's because I want you guys to be able to trust that. And I feel like people who only have positive things to say, you know, for me, it's hard for me to trust their word on a product because it's like, yeah, but you love everything. Like, this isn't your money that's getting spent. This is my money. Okay, so I'm mixing up sort of a dirty looking color over here using yellow ochre, burnt sienna, and a little bit of indigo. And that's because his armor, the white parts of his armor is really like sort of battle grade on purpose. Like if he commissioned someone, I'm not really sure, put a lot of time into making this costume look like it belongs to a world. Like it is something that saw use. So that's definitely an element that I want to capture because someone put so much time into that, that it must be important. And that the blue green that I had originally put down as the background is actually going to kind of help me because it's going to push that weather-beaten look. And then all I really have to worry about is making sure those reds get bright enough that they pop and the black gets dark enough that it looks like deep and, well, black, not gray. And this is just the first sort of all over layer of grunge. I'm definitely going to strategically darken it in some areas. But like I said, on your first pass, it's often better to come in kind of light, and that gives you some reference. Okay, I think I hit all of the areas of white on him. So they are going to turn out so cute. I think if I can just get this brusho to not be so obvious, they're going to come out really cute. And I'm excited about this commission. And I'm glad he took a chance on me, because often people in cool costumes rather than cute costumes, I see them look at my booth and I see them think about it. And I want them to commission me because I love drawing this kind of stuff, but they often don't. And the thing is, it's not that I don't have examples. I do. They like sell immediately. People really like the cool plus cute. I mean, look at how popular Funko Pop is. And I'm not necessarily a fan of how Funko Pop handles cute, but that's my personal opinion. And they seem to do really, really well. So clearly there's an audience for it, even if I'm not it. You know, I love it when I get commissioned to do kind of cool, cute things. And I ought to have some like permanent examples in my that I just leave in my commission portfolio because I enjoy doing them so much. I do Gundams like once a year. And if my younger brother doesn't buy them all, as soon as he sees them on Facebook... He's a big Gundam fanatic, though. Then usually I get like a private message from somebody I don't know who's like, I saw this on my friend's feed and I knew I had to have it. So I don't get to take my Gundams to cons. Mix that black in with that darker black that I had mixed up. And I need to take a break because I have several things that are wet. All right, so everything has had kind of a chance to dry. So now I can continue to move forward. I'm gonna go ahead and mix up the purple, at least the blue for the purple, and see if I can't get that started. So I take a little bit of indigo. And the indigo is the warmest blue this set has. And it's, it's a lot warmer than the other blue. But it's still not really warm enough. However, it's going to work just fine for this. Because the red I used is so blue. All right, that's the basics of that. And I think I've mentioned to you guys in other videos that I recommend you work from like large to small. So don't focus on trying to get tiny details in too early. Focus instead on blocking in. And if you get, I thought about keeping that bleed. If it was a personal commission, if it was a piece for myself, I would have kept that because I like how that looks. I like when you can see that this is actually watercolor. I like those happy accidents. That's something you have to fight for if you're doing digital art. You have to put those happy accidents in yourself. Whereas watercolor, you can encourage them for sure, but it'll also offer them up to you. But since this is for someone else, and I debated whether or not I should dab it up, and it's still there a little bit. I didn't want him to think I was just being sloppy or lazy. My personal preference is not always other people's preference. Also sort of hoping that this additional layer of skin tone will push back those greens even further. Some, like on the legs, well, that's just kind of a loss. That is what it is. There's not going to be a whole lot I can do with that, and there's no point in trying to cover it up with too much effort, because it's going to look, the more effort you throw into hiding something like that, the muddier and the worse it's going to look. So it's better to just sort of embrace those irregularities and try to work with them. one of the problems with going with your gut and doing things to your taste is that sometimes it's just not the customer's taste. And then you have a decision to make. You could redo the commission, or you can refund their money, or you can try and argue it with them. Now, if they're the ones who change their minds at the last minute and you have documentation, it's really up to you as to whether or not you want to refund them. Unfortunately, with the internet, you are more likely to get a bad name than you are to get a good name. It takes longer to build a good reputation than it takes to ruin it. So with most commissions, if they're unhappy and they have a good reason, and I feel like their reason is valid, and it's a hard shake for me not to think it's valid, I will probably offer to redo it or refund them just because I want them to be happy. I want them to be satisfied with the experience. Too many people have been burnt in the past with commissions, not from me, but just in general. So I want to do what I can to help remedy that situation and make commissions something that people are willing to consider. And I mentioned in one of my prior videos that a lot of people who have a reason to distrust commissions, it's because they've been burned in the past. So they have a good reason to be on edge on it. So I definitely want to make their experience as positive and as easy as I can. But in the end, the way you choose to handle customers who are not happy with something, that's up to you. One I do regret is when I do commissions, I advertise that I can work from a description. And this is great for people who, maybe it's a D&D character, or maybe they're writing a novel and they don't have reference yet, and they want something that they can take to other artists who aren't willing to work from description to have their character drawn. And I had this one girl at AWA years ago who had a character, and she didn't have any solid anything for her. Not a face claim, couldn't say what she looked like, couldn't say what she dressed like. All she could say is that she had red hair and liked denim clothing, that kind of thing, and like flannel shirts. And I did a design for her. I did a character for her, and it was close but not close enough. And basically she had me go through three iterations while she figured out her character. And I really should have charged her for each iteration. At this point, I'd be like, okay, when you commissioned me for this, the agreement was you either have to be very specific with what you want or you need to cut me some slack. Because this, at the time, I was only charging $15 for that particular type of commission anyway, and I'd spent several hours working on it. I really should have put my foot down. And I would now I would have to tell her that I followed the instructions she'd given me, and that if she wanted another, I could give her a discount rate, but that I wouldn't be eating the cost. But that's something that having a good reputation, and a few years under your belt, that's something you'll earn, you'll unlock, you'll gain with time. And I'm only bringing that up not because it was such a bad experience I just had to tell you guys, but rather because that seems like a pretty common scenario. The person you're commissioning is overly laid back, and you're not really sure what you want. And I mean, you see it when they finish it, and yeah, it's good, it looks good, but it's not your character, it just doesn't feel right. And like, I mean, if the person offers to redo it and they're not charging you, you're not really going to insist that they pay you. I mean, that you pay them, sorry. So, I mean, that was the sort of thing that I had to personally experience it before I could decide whether or not to allow that to happen. Because I don't mind doing a redesign, but I mean, our time has value. And if you did a good job on the first one and you acted in good faith and you followed all of the requirements they had and they're still not satisfied, well, then, I mean, you could switch to your hourly rate if you want. But I think it's pretty fair for a convention style commission, which tends to be cheaper than like online commissions or in-person private commissions. It seems fair to me that you would tell them you wouldn't have a revisions clause. And some of my friends do larger, more detailed commissions, and they might allow for revisions clauses, but they're also making more money from it. So when you're deciding on what kind of commissions you want to offer, and you're deciding on what price point you want to offer them at, you do need to take your time into consideration and whether or not you would be open to doing revisions, especially on physical stuff. On digital stuff, sometimes it's a lot easier. Oh, you need the pants, the color of the pants switch? No problem. I can do that real quick. But that's not how traditional media works. And you may have to explain that to your customers, that it's not as easy as, you know, toggling a layer or doing a color fill or, you know, setting a layer to multiply. And I know that seems like a duh, but if all of your friends are digital artists, you may be tempted to try and do the things that they're doing but in a traditional way. And a lot of the things that they can do, because it's digital and it's very forgiving, you're not going to have access to. I mean, if this was digital, I would definitely go back and clean up around the legs and I would have the fill a little bit better. But I mean, this is actual watercolor, so there's only so much I can do. And Brusho has some pretty significant staining properties, and you have to debate whether or not you want to tear up the paper surface in order to fix something. And sometimes the things you would personally have a problem with, you would fix, your customer might be fine with. Or they might like it because what they wanted was that traditional media, and the things that you considered a flaw are just signs that it is indeed a physical piece. Like, I'm going to use mine as an example again. Like the Brusho blooms, for example, that could go either way. The customer might not like it because it doesn't look as clean as he was hoping for. The customer might love it because it really looks like watercolor. And there's just often no way of knowing until you are in contact with them. They've seen it, you know. And by that point, if you're like me and it's just like a little commission like this, they're not going to see it until it's finished. That's another thing. Don't get me wrong, but on the cheaper commissions, I've really found that it's best to have the customer just sort of trust that you know what you're doing as an artist. I know some artists who, I've actually commissioned artists who they need me to check in with my commission at every point. And I will check in with them because they've asked me to, but I'm thinking to myself, like, I commissioned you and I trust you. I wouldn't have given you the money if I didn't trust you. Do what you think is right. I want to see how you handle the character. I try to limit how much I check in with my customers on little pieces like this, because sometimes with watercolor, you have an ugly stage, and you as the watercolor artist, you know it's the ugly stage, you know it's going to look better, you know where it's going, but someone who isn't as familiar with the medium may not be able to see where it's going, and so they may get scared and want you to start from scratch. And that hasn't happened to me personally, but it happened to a friend of mine, and she's a fellow watercolor artist, and I saw the piece that she was working on, and I knew it was going to turn out beautiful because I'd seen her other work, but her customer didn't look at her process stuff that she'd shared online, or I don't know, but couldn't have faith in my friend's ability to make the piece shine. And they got cold feet and they wanted her to do it from scratch. And there was really no call for her to do it from scratch, but she did. On a larger commission, like a $50 watercolor, I will definitely check in at least with the penciled roughs just to make sure the pose is okay. I might ask them about, well, I'll definitely ask them about a palette if they seem to have like a specific thing in mind. Definitely check in on poses, make sure the clothes are right. But on little commissions like this, they usually don't see them until they're completely finished. And that's mostly because if I waited on a little commission like this, if I had to wait for a customer to get back to me on something, it might never get finished. I have customers who I've emailed, I email almost all my customers finished scans of their commissions, especially take-homes. And often they just don't ever reply to me. And in the email, I ask them to let me know when the physical piece arrives, and I just never hear from them again. So if I were waiting on a customer to give me the go-ahead with some of these, I would just never be able to finish it. Even with people who I told them at the con, I always explain the process. I always explain, you know, I'm going to email you a scan and then I'm going to mail you the physical piece. And that's because my mailman here, I think he hates me. It doesn't help that I order, you know, 40-pound bags of cat litter and he has to carry them down the hill. In fact, I'm pretty sure that is why he hates me. But he's been bending my commissions, like commissions that I purchased that were sent to me. He's been bending them to fit in the mailbox, regardless of what the package says, since before I started ordering cat litter online. So that's why I make sure I email a scan to all of my customers, because, you know, if my mailman hates me enough that he doesn't care, they might have a mailman who hates them too, a mail person. And I would be really bummed out if, you know, something that they'd paid for that I worked hard on got ruined just because their mailman doesn't like them or doesn't like delivering mail, or I don't know. And I'm sure there are wonderful, wonderful mail people out there. My particular mailman hates me. And it probably has to do with the big bags of cat litter. Okay, so I need to let this dry again before I can proceed. All right, so everything is dry for now. So I'm going to go ahead and darken that purple by applying a little more indigo. And I can also do another layer on her hair. So a little bit more red. And the red definitely helps hide some of the seafoam green and turquoise from the background that kind of seeped into her hair. And her hair is more red than red blonde, so I want to make sure I get enough red in there. And I think the next layer on her hair is just going to be plain old scarlet. And I think I could even afford to go darker with the black in his hair. We'll see. I definitely want to start going darker with the black on his uniform. I'm going to mix that separately in case I want to go back to that original color. Now, when a commission artist or an artist in general complains that the piece got away from them, it usually isn't about the subject matter at all. It's just like the materials they were using that evening just weren't really cooperating, or the weather was being funky, so things weren't really drying, or they were like bleeding into each other. It's not a statement about the piece itself. It's a statement about the struggle the artist went through to make sure the piece turned out right. So if an artist says that about a commission they did for you, it's not about you necessarily. It's not about your characters. Just about, the materials they were using, the weather outside. Maybe they couldn't get a hold of the paper they prefer to use, so they weren't used to the new paper they had to use instead. Just checking for shine to see if I can progress on to the next stage. Something else I was thinking about as a commissioner or a commission artist, but I've been on both sides, is you shouldn't, if you can't do something, not like if you just know you can't, if you know you're not going to be able to put the time in. Or if you know you don't have the materials, or let's say you're a digital artist and they really want a watercolor commission, don't take their money because you are hurting them and you're hurting yourself. I mean, if they absolutely insist, no, it has to be you. I love your style. I don't mind if it doesn't look as good as other watercolor artists. I don't expect that. I just love your style. I just want to see your style in watercolor. That's a different story. But if they're just kind of like casually interested, don't push something you know you can't do, and don't take money for something you know you can't do. You're going to regret it because it's going to be hard and it's not going to turn out right, and it's going to make your work look bad. They're going to regret it because they paid money for it and they're going to be disappointed. So, if you just honestly not good at something, you know you're not going to be good at it, you never put the time in to learn, you don't really have any interest in learning, just don't take it. I'm not going to say there's no shame, because I mean, anytime somebody wants me to do, I remember my favorite freelance client. He was doing some concept art and he really, really, really wanted to hire me to help him out with it. And like, I just don't have any experience with digital concept art. And he wanted a really realistic style. And I was just like, there's just no way I could do this for you in the time you have with the budget you have. Like, it's just not fair to you. Let me recommend a couple of my friends who specialize in this kind of thing. And I mean, I would have really enjoyed the project. The project seemed really cool, but I respected this guy too much. I respected his business and his time too much to like yank his chain while I learned how to do something to get caught up with everybody else who already knew how. And that's a skill set I'd love to have, but I just couldn't in good conscience take his money for something that I have just no ability in. I mean, that's on me because I should work to develop those skills. Especially if that's something I would be interested in doing. All right, time to let this dry again. This hair is almost dark enough. All right, so everything is dry. It's time to get back to work. If I'm working on a single piece at a time, I'll usually step away and go do something else for a little bit to give it time to dry so I'm not, like, overworking it. Oh, I'm going to need to rotate my canvas so I'll have better access to her hair. And we're going right for the gusto here with the brilliant red. But it's a little bright, so I'm going to mix in some burnt sienna as well. And maybe even cool it down a little. And really, if you're going to be working with paint watercolors that have more opacity, you really want to wait kind of towards the end. Because if you use them too early and you try to put layers over them, they're going to make everything look really muddy. But if you wait until the end, that pop of opacity will, it'll just sort of like mask areas that were a problem and it'll just look nice and solid. It's hard to explain as I'm doing it. But I have found that putting off doing my more opaque layers is usually a pretty good idea. I might have gone a little too brown. We'll see when it dries. And I also want to start working in more black into his hair. Unfortunately, the soccer koi set, the opaque colors can be kind of chalky. So instead of looking like a nice strong black over dark brown, it instead looks chalky over dark brown. And that's just sort of the nature of these paints. This is one of the reasons why I'm a big proponent for if you want to seriously learn how to watercolor and you want to be able to do a lot of layers and you want to do lighting effects, you're really better off not going with the cheap stuff because the cheap stuff performs a lot differently than the mid-range or even the expensive stuff. And you may end up so frustrated that you just quit. Like, it's just not worth your time and you throw in the towel. Which is why I always advise, if you're serious about something, and you know you're going to stick with it for a while, try to buy the best you can afford. Student grade watercolor papers are often kind of terrible and they require a lot of finagling and finessing. And that's fine if you're a artist who's been doing it a while and you know that this is going to happen and you know what to do. But if you're a beginning artist, you may not even be able to find tutorials online to help you make accommodations for those issues. I mean, there's definitely a phase of learning something where you're so new to it that you don't even know what you don't know. So you don't even know how to Google something to find out the answer. You don't even know if you're the problem, the product's the problem, your technique is the problem. Could be any of those things. So you can at least take the materials out of the equation sometimes by doing your research and opting for the best that you can afford at the time. I feel like it's a very pat answer to tell aspiring younger artists, just get the cheap stuff, you'll learn, and then when you're good, you can buy the good stuff. Because it's like, you're forgetting all those times where I'm going to use watercolor because that's what I do. You're using the cheapest Montval student grade watercolor, right? Because somebody told you, get the cheap stuff, and you're trying to do a watercolor comic. In fact, first chapter of 7-inch Kara was painted on Canson's cheap student grade stuff with a mix of Winsor Newton and Cotman paints, and I hate Cotman paints. Even though I was stretching the paper, I'd never been shown how to properly stretch the paper, and I was having difficulty finding resources that didn't include expensive, like, stretcher bars and stuff, like resources that were actively trying to push expensive stretching equipment. And I was just learning, but boy, that paper fought. I couldn't do anything on that paper. I couldn't do washes. I couldn't blot stuff out. I couldn't lift stuff up. It didn't matter how I stretched it. It would end up buckling all over the place. That paper was awful. And my art really improved after chapter one because I switched over to Canson Montval, which is a slightly better quality paper. I was able to move from 90-pound watercolor paper to 140-pound, which is, like, seriously, if you're doing bigger pieces or if you're doing comics or you plan on really working the paper, you really need a heavier paper. And I still have to stretch it. I also figured out a stretching technique that worked for me, even if it isn't the official way to stretch watercolor paper. Somebody introduced me to gator boards. So instead of using crappy MDF lap boards that would splinter all over the place if they got wet, as a stretcher support, I was using gator boards, which are lightweight plastic, very affordable, economical. You can cut them down to size. Like, the combination of experience, better resources, and better materials drastically improved the sort of art I was trying to make. So I always get kind of cagey when I hear other artists who are very flip about, oh, don't worry about it. As you get better, you'll notice you can start using better stuff. And it's like, yeah, but if you're always using a terrible material, you might just walk away before you ever get better, or you'll never be able to improve because you can't practice the sort of techniques you need to practice because the paper just can't handle it. And I get upset about that kind of stuff because I do a lot of public FaceTime when I'm at conventions. I talk to people and I look at sketchbooks and I ask them what they want to do. And I do panels. I do a lot of one-on-one. And I get a lot of people who were told to use the cheap stuff and they tried it and it looks horrible and they're about to give up. Like, I'm one of the ones who are helping to clean up those messes. So I'm tired of seeing this. I'm tired of seeing people who are too young to be sad about something like this. And I think those of you who say this kind of stuff casually need to take some responsibility for it. You either need to share tutorials showing these kids how to use it, or you need to maybe reframe how you think about giving advice to people. I'm not saying your hearts aren't in the right place. I'm sure they are. But even I, like, the more time I spend when I'm not doing cheap art supply challenges, when I'm not doing cheap art supply series on the blog, I get very complacent. I get very cozy with my expensive supplies, and I forget just how hard it was to use some of those cheaper things. If you are one of those artists giving advice and you do use the cheap stuff every day, like Lemmy A Crescent, for example, does these beautiful pieces with Crayola crayons. I mean, they look amazing. And she even does tutorials explaining how she does it. And of course, you can't expect to get her results the very first time you do it. But the fact that she uses these materials regularly and also creates tutorials so that other people can learn to use them too gives a lot of credibility when she says, it's fine if you use this. Don't worry about the more expensive stuff. If you're only using the cheap stuff for a cheap art supply challenge and the entire time you're giggling about how awful the paper is, it's really hard to take you seriously when you are later telling kids, see, it doesn't matter what you use, because it's like, yeah, but you have 10 years experience on these 16-year-olds and you've forgotten what it was like when all you could afford was this and everything you did turned out kind of awful. And yeah, that's an important thing to go through. Like, I definitely went through that myself, where I only could afford the cheap stuff, and I was always dreaming of, like, Copics and Prismacolors. And that's an important part of being a young artist, I think. Like, I'm not saying you need to tell them, oh, only buy the best. That's not what I'm saying. Because that's a whole nother kettle of fish, and you're definitely opening yourself up to some obnoxious comments. I'm just saying you can't casually say the cheap stuff is fine, just use the cheap stuff, because there's a lot of gray area in there that you're just kind of blithely ignoring. And if you that firmly believe that the cheap stuff is okay, then consider doing some outreach to show other people how to use it. Or consider doing a month where you only use those materials and you share them on Instagram. You don't really owe anybody this. But if that ad revenue that comes from those videos where you're blithely giggling about, oh, the paper's so awful, I got it from the Dollar Tree. And then in the next sentence saying, see kids, you don't need expensive supplies to make good work. If those are the videos that get you a lot of ad revenue, it makes sense to me that creating a tutorial and monetizing said tutorial would not only help feed the hungry minds that want to understand how to use what they can afford, it would also bring you a lot of ad traffic and a lot of money. All right, so things are dry, so it's time to keep moving on. And I'm going to start darkening certain areas on his armor, specifically the red areas, based on my reference. I definitely check my reference frequently when I'm doing these. Now, his legs have some black straps that are going to go across here, so I guess it's time to go ahead and knock those in. I'd kind of put it off until I had everything else kind of more solidified. So blend out some of the black over there and darken this here. And blend that out a bit. And let's see, strap goes here. And I'm definitely going to darken this. This is just me sort of sketching in paint. Sketch goes here. Right here. And right there. Because it's a lot easier for me to, if I need to take a paper towel and pick this up or scrub it out with a brush than it would be for me to scrub out black. And there's a lot of distressing on his armor. and try to indicate that to an extent. And his uniform also has some opaque red. Sort of hard to see because there are a lot of shapes going on. And it's not super duper clear. So I think if I just hint at it, will be in good shape. Now with these dark reds, if you can't get them dark enough, if you mix in with this particular set, with the Sakura Koi 12-piece set, if you mix in a little bit of the indigo, it'll make it appear purple, which works really good for knocking in some shadow on your reds. And you can also go over it again with your dark red if it's too blue, which there's gonna be areas where I'm gonna have to do that. But I'm gonna let it dry first because, like I've said a dozen times, paint dries lighter than it goes down. So before I like rush to fix something that might not be a problem, I want to see how it turns out. I don't want it to go too opaque too quickly. And sometimes with this particular set, that can be a problem. I've been using this set for convention style commissions for 4 years now, and I have painted like hundreds of these things, and I still have trouble sometimes predicting what the set's gonna do. So yet another reason why, if you want to do serious stuff and you can afford to pony up the money for something better, read reviews and consider making that investment, because that's what it is. It's an investment. You're investing in yourself. All right, I think it's time to let, actually, I want to lift some of the stuff in her hair, because the opaque brown is just too dark and too saturated of a brown. It's not quite as brown red as I would like. So I'm going to gently lift some areas that I'm going to repaint in with the orange that I'd mixed, just to sort of preserve what her hair actually looks like in the photo. Right now, her hair is getting a little bit muddy looking. So I'm going to repaint some areas of it. All right, so I need to let the paper dry before I can do that. All right, so I think that's, I think it's dry enough to be able to take it. So I'm painting some of that orange back in. It got a little brown for my taste in terms of looking like the person I'm painting. I actually have brown hair myself, so I don't have a problem with brown hair. I just am trying to capture a likeness. So going to pink up her knees if I can. And her knuckles, and her bottom lip a little bit more. And And since his armor is pretty much dry, I can start doing some of the fine details on it. So first I want to go with the distress color I mixed up. And I'm also kind of trying, because in real life, his armor has been distressed to look battle-worn. So I'm trying to kind of replicate that look as well in the painting. There are places where it looks like the paint came off. That's where the gray dings kind of come in. And there's areas that would have been in shadow. So I'm kind of marking those a little bit better as well. Now, dings can go two ways. They can be indents, which look darker, but they can also have highlights where they kind of catch the light. So you can handle them either way or both ways. Both ways is going to give you a more realistic look. If done right, it's going to definitely read more like distress battle armor than either method on its own. They're even some kind of brownish, like rust kind of spots. This leg here. So I'm going to paint those in. It's all part of capturing a likeness. Also, it's just kind of fun. Like, I think sometimes doing a lot of careful detail judiciously on my like chibi style drawings, I think that can be a lot of fun because it's something people aren't necessarily expecting and they seem to respond to it really. All right, so oh, her hair's still wet, so I can't go back and re-add the striations on her hair just yet. Can start better delineating her legs though. Oh, gotta be careful, that's damp. And I can also go in and make sure I hit that dimple in her cheek. And as I work on pieces like this, I often lean in to get a closer look. I'm looking for the reflection on the paper. It helps me see whether or not there's like standing water on the surface. If there's standing water on the surface, you might as well just wait because you're not anything you, I mean, if you want like a very blended wet into wet technique, then that's what you're looking for. You want that. But if you're trying to get like a sharp line, or if you're putting down a whole different color, you really want to make sure that wet is gone because it can end in tears. Also, her shoes were a little bit darker brown than I had accounted for. So I'm going to grab some of the dark brown I'd mixed up for his hair. and just sort of darken them a little bit more. So when I was younger, my younger brother, who is really into Gundam, they came out with battle scarred Gundams. Like Toonami was doing the ads for them. And I remember how psyched he was because, like, instead of looking like toys that come from a box, they looked more like models. So I think about that when I'm doing these sort of commissions that for people who do went to the time to distress their armor, that's important to them. Like, that is time and energy, and they want recognition for that effort. And cheating them of that by leaving it out or being overly lazy or, you know, whatever, that's a shame because that's part of the commission. That's also, to me, that's also fun. It doesn't have to be perfect. You can be kind of loose. It's a good chance to practice some of those techniques that you might not otherwise get to trot out. Right, that needs to dry. Okay, so I think we're finally hitting the point where the end is kind of in sight. At least I hope so. Now I can finally pull out my detail brush and start delineating some things and adding fine detail. Oh, I gotta watch where my hand goes because there is some wet paint on the page. And I also want to pull in some darker details into her hair because it is sort of starting to lose some of its mass. Now, I don't want any of you to take this the wrong way, especially those of you who might be interested in commissioning me in the future. But my favorite part of any art piece is when I'm nearing the end, because I really love seeing things come together and I really like fighting through the ugly stage and seeing it be worth it. And that's not to say I don't enjoy working on your commissions, and it's not to say I'm not grateful for them. It's just saying that for me, the best part is kind of near the end where things start to come together, start to make a little more sense, start to look like what I thought it would look like in my head. I also really like the stage where I'm sort of interchangeably using the white, opaque white, along with like doing detailing and color, because that's when things start moving really quick. However, before I can get to that stage, I have a whole lot of black details I need to do on his uniform. And I need to go darker than that, because that's not going to show up. That should be right. All right, time to pull out that opaque white. And now I'll probably be moving between the two fairly frequently. So one of the first things I need to do is reestablish white highlights. And also, not enough water. Here, highlights. And whiten up the teeth. And it's white around these. And I mentioned in other videos, you can use white gouache. I like to use I like to use Copic opaque white. It's very convenient. It can be sort of blended out a bit. And adding all this white is really going to help pop the characters out of the background. Which, since there are some shared elements, is definite, like some of the blue green has seeped in, right, like to their ears and stuff. So having the white will help. Oh, I got kind of that. Let me see if I can blend that out. Anyway, having the white will help push the contrast so they just don't look like they're being consumed by the background. And personally, you don't want to be overly reliant on the sort of fixes your opaque white of any type are going to do for you. Mostly because there's going to be things that it just can't salvage. And you don't want to be in a situation where you are relying on that opaque white to save something. I mean, it's sort of the sort of thing where, like, if it can save it, that's great. But if it can't, you have other tricks up your sleeve. And even with this piece, where the background honestly did kind of get away from me for a while, I didn't want the opaque white to be my savior. I wanted to be able to do as much fixing through like color choice or color placement or strategically hiding certain elements. I wanted to be able to rely on that instead, because that's something that is much more in my control. Now, if you find your opaque white is a little too white, you can tint it to blend in a little bit better. And it's never going to look like, you know, you hadn't put opaque white down. It's going to look like you corrected it, but it won't look as noticeable. And it may be better than the alternative. So that's also something to think about. Now her ear could definitely benefit from being pulled out of the background. So now I am trying to, and I might not do such a great job of it. I might, okay, yeah, it's not gonna work like that. That's fine. I'm trying to pop her ear out the way I did with his, and then kind of subtly go over it with the peach. That way we're kind of cutting some of that blue color a little bit. Hopefully, that's like the plan. It got away from me a bit. There we go. So I'm going to recolor her ears after that has dried. Just want to kind of soften that. And if you are in the audience and you think this is cheating, well, it is kind of. But I would rather do what I have to do to make sure my customers get a commission that makes them happy, even if I have to really fudge some of the corrections. I would rather do that than play kind of by the books and they not be happy. I mean, with a little con watercolor commission like this anyway, nobody is expecting fine art. They're expecting to see themselves drawn like anime characters. So if I can give them that, and I do a good job and they're happy, then I'm happy. Her dress had kind of a delicate, like a paisley effect on it, and most of that was in white, so of course my hand is picking up some of the Brusho because it's a dye, so it will, if you sweat on it, it will travel with you. It's kind of frustrating like that because like I have so much trouble with it, right, on influencing their skin tone. Like that really, that was difficult for me to try and push back. And I used all the tricks that I knew of, from trying to pick it up while it was still wet to going warmer with my skin tone than I normally would, to doing like a cover-up job, basically, like I'm doing with the opaque white there. And it wouldn't budge. Like you guys saw me fight with it. And yet it will pick up on my hand like no problem. And that's not necessarily a problem with the Brusho. It's just it's definitely a problem with my handling of it though. Really need to invest, in fact, in a calligrapher or a watercolorist mall stick, because that would be closer to the surface of my paper than a traditional mall stick, which is intended to elevate. If you're not familiar, it's intended to elevate your hand a bit when you're painting so that you're not, or drawing, like using graphite, so you're not dragging your hand across sort of a delicate surface. And the watercolorists and calligraphers are interested in those tools. However, we're so far up that it like physically hurts our hands to use them. So I used to have a mall stick, and then I think we gave it, or a bridge. It was a bridge. I had a bridge, and I ended up donating it because it was so high up that it physically hurt my hand and my wrist to use it. Yeah, you can tell I did a touch-up job on that ear. I was hoping it would be subtle like the other one. I think there's just too much turquoise over there for it to not look obvious. And with this sort of simplified style, you really want to have a light hand when you're drawing patterns on clothes. You don't want it to be very overwhelming. You aren't even really trying to capture the pattern itself. You're just trying to capture the way it feels when you look at it. All right, I'm pretty satisfied with this. There's a couple of things I'm going to do. All right, I'm gonna let that dry and let one of my colors evaporate a little bit because I need it to be a little bit darker, but well, actually two of my colors a little bit, but then I'm just about done. All right, so for real, we are just about done. There's a couple things I wanted to do before I take a picture and put it on Instagram. I just want to delineate a couple of features a little bit better. Oh, I hit a patch of Brusho. Let's see if I can get that picked up. Because it's like blue. And it doesn't belong there. So if you're kind of a nitpick person who could work on something forever, one of the signs that you should consider that it's time for you to stop working is when you hit a patch of Brusho or you go to add detail in the mouth and the line for no reason goes into the opaque white that you put down. You know, when you start having those kind of accidents, and you're in the end stages anyway, it's probably time to call it a night and to decide that it looks good enough and you don't need to continue to nitpick, because I will pick at something forever if allowed, even if it looks great and even if there would be no discernible difference. So I'm going to take that as a natural stopping point. Call this one finished. I like how it looks. I think it turned out pretty great. I think they're going to like it. I hope they're going to like it. If you like it and you're interested in commissioning me for a similar piece, shoot, my 9x12 detail Chibi. Let me see what I quoted them. I quoted them 30. Ideally, I'd like to get 35 because it is a much bigger piece than... Oop. The 8x8, I mean, really, like, way bigger than the 8x8. But email me, and we can talk. I'm Becca Hilburn. This was a tutorial on how I do my detailed con commissions, my detailed Chibi con commissions. I hope you found it useful. I hope you found it helpful. I hope you found it inspiring. If you would like to help make more content like this, more tutorials aimed at helping people get going on commissions or finding a watercolor style or what have you, please consider checking out my Patreon, patreon.com/natosoup, because I depend on your emotional support and financial support from my audience in order to make even more great content. If you can't afford that or you're not comfortable or whatever reason, that's fine. You're under no obligation. I would really appreciate it, however, if you shared this video to your social network so that others might benefit from it. You'd be doing me a big favor because you'd be helping me expand my audience as well, which would be great. I would love that. If you're new to my channel, I highly recommend you subscribe if you enjoyed this video, because I do tutorials, reviews, demonstrations, sketchbook tours, at least once a week, often twice a week. There's always new content to see. And I recommend you check out my blog, natosoup.blogspot.com. It's been going for 7 years, and it's stuff like this, except static. So I'm Becca Hilburn. I hope you guys have a great evening. Bye.